morning, and thanks for having me. Thanks to the friends from the team, hopefully all that happened in Christian and Tanya, and thanks to all the people having me this morning. My name is Alishine Osman. I'm originally from Zimbabwe. When I was 6 years old, when I was 4 or 5, my parents wanted me to succeed in the country. My father was a well-known religious man. My mother was a home of a restaurant. We lived in a beautiful city with a smile. Our house was located just across the Indian Ocean. It was literally a piece of stone and stone in the Indian Ocean. It was a beautiful city. But the city was Somalia erupted, and we were attacked by rebels one morning. My father was shot. My mother tried to get in, and she was kicked and left. And then the rebels took everything, confiscated our property, and the war was intensified, and we had to flee the city. We went to Kenya. It took us several weeks, over 400, 500 miles. And when we arrived in Kenya, we were still by the United Nations. We were put in a small camp. We stayed there for a couple of days, and then because of the heavy rain, the tent was sent away, and we started to be our own house. We had a small refuge, and whatever we could get. That's how we started in a new refugee camp. We call it a refugee camp, a place where we concentration camp, the Tibetan concentration camp in California, or something along that line, but it's not. It was pretty hot during the day and pretty cold during the night, and sometimes it's crazy, and we have to pull it from the roof. So we continued to be the camp for the next 3 years. That was beautiful. I remember when a number of our kids came together, we wanted to ask for them, so but that's the only way we could help ourselves. I volunteered for partner resources. I served a little study of my students who are 9, 10, 11. I really go to school, so the volunteers came together. We don't have books, we don't have pens, nothing, and so we have to write a few pieces of the dirt and get a little warm, and that's how I got to use my country. And then several years later, we established schools, UNPR, we had a commercial care from Kenya, some of the institutions. I established a school, and they were not people, so everyone in the school was all of it. We go to school in the morning, about 4 or 5 miles we walk without breakfast, and then we come back home, probably have a little lunch, and occasionally we end up having no light at all. And so some of my students went down to city in Kenya, but the theme is really kind of on that level of love. So, and that is one of the things I did. People were the first one that was established in the way I live. In 1920, about 2,000 refugees were settled in this camp. But over the year, the number of refugees continues to grow. And so by 2007, we have close to half a million refugees in the camp. And so, the likelihood of one person to settle for the refugee camp to the United States, Florida, was very, very, very limited. Because the United States of America was the 50% chance to all. All the refugees I have to. So, 2007, I was told my parents came to my house and said, I should be able to get the worst thing that day. Okay, you don't call me, so my name, but. So, that's what I want to do. My name was selected as first to be in April 2007, and I was not to settle until September 2007. That moment identified, because what is the settlement process that takes years, some people it takes 5 years, 6 years, 7 years. But I was probably like this person. When my name was selected in April, my process was completed in September, but that span of time for me it was like years, because that's not the way to go to the end. So I went through the process, and then what happened is once you go through the interview, and then you have medical, you have background check. What happens is at least what the process most of the time, once you go through the medical, your medical is approved, and then you do the interview, then you do your background. Now, the process may have a little bit, fault or something might happen, and then your medical expires, and then you have to take your medical, and then your background expires, and then the medical is ready, and then once your background comes in, your medical expires, so people get that cycle for 15 years forever. And the reason I'm trying is I was a lucky person because in that time, today, there are 72.3 billion people who sleep abroad. That was a report from the UN, that was in 2020. This year, probably that was today. About 25 million are probably, over 1 million. So, in the Dadaab alone, it had 350,000. By 2011, it had half a million people. So, getting settled to be, how many people would be settled? 50,000 to be connected across the world, and another 50,000 the rest of the African country, that's about 10,000 people. And that's not only for that, the number is that's for the world. And so, the job, 350,000 people, 500,000 people every year, 12 million children are born. Only 1,000 people are settled. So, implementation, integration, all of that are not a solution for them. Because 12,000 children are born and only one person is settled. That's why I consider myself the largest person, because I know the people that are born in the refugee camp and have 3 or 4 children now. And the refugee camp is very difficult because it's shipping food, it's physical order, everything can be involved. They build small house that is built with cars and men and all that, but they need to be one to create and build up businesses to build another one. Some people, they have no proper clothing. I remember when I was in school, I would wash my shirt. The night before I go there, it's not, everything is different. People go for a thing, I would have a dry on the shirt and all that. I wouldn't have anything. I mean, I would take that chart I have if I want to live with Dory and I want to go to school tomorrow. I either wash tonight or I don't have my own, to use. So, and I don't use a baby, the water, there's a salt thing to use if you don't have, you just wash it with the same water with your hands. And then you dry it and then you wear it again. So, for 5 years, 6 years, And so in 2007, when I was settled, I came to Texas. And I was picked up from the airport and put in my apartment, and I just got there to come back and do the next day. No problem. I was sitting in my apartment at 12 midnight, and 3 p.m. next day, was 12 a.m. So 3 p.m. when I came out of, I was like, let's see how it looks, you know, how it looks, because I was in the plane, airport, and in the apartment. I wanted to see how they look. And then out of my apartment, and they were police, several of them. There was an incident outside of my apartment. And I opened the door. And I just remember I came from Miami just to advise, you know, we consider police, you know, like here, they protect us, you know, but for us, we need to be surrounded from them because they hit you, you know, there's a lot of corruption. So when I came out and I saw this police, I tried to lock my door because I was scared of them. But then because of the camp, you see a police and then you try to hide, they will come up to you because you were suspicious. So I was like, oh, if you close the door and they come up to you, what's going to happen? And then I opened the door. And trust me, this has nothing to do with me. I just arrived and this was the truth. Other folks, I had my idea what they were doing. So, when I visited, I never forget this story. When I saw the car, there was one of them was a female car, and you don't get to see female car in the country. All of them, if you can. So, the woman was my dad, and then that was the way for me to say, I've never been on a car by a keyboard. Because for us, cops were there in New York, they were there, and in Somalia, especially the people who had the uniform, and the people who took part in this, you know. Because Somalia was people went along the pipeline, they climbed, so either the person who was wearing a uniform, in order to fight back, he tried hiding from his tribe, nobody was wearing the uniform. So that day, after several days in the camp, in Houston, Texas, I started working. I was so careful with what the camera had a job. But here, people don't know how to navigate these systems, and for me, I was a dad, I was a kid. Sometimes I got social security, and my work family came in, and I needed a driver's license. So I called a lot of people to see that stuff. So I saw a lot of people and I get a volunteer. She told me I needed social security and work permit. I didn't need work permit yet. But in order for me to get a work permit, you needed regular residence or ID, you needed a work permit. But for me, I said I have to get a residence so I can start working. Some people, they told me, there's no way, and then I have to work with this for a long time, and I know there's no way. And I said, I'm going to take everything that I came with in this country, the whole packet, and I'll go and see what they say. This is me a letter, she gave me a letter with the dog, and she said, I had it coming, and we looked there with the examiner, what do you have? I said, I have social security, I have travel documents, I don't have one. She said, do you have your medical? I said, which medical? The one you use the IRS often, the people you know. Yeah, I do. And she took it and she gave me a medical. That's what they learned from me my first time I came to the country. And she told me, I'm sure you're going to be using this information because she said she has been working for refugees and she never knew that she could get one to get. I didn't have one for them. So the next day I went to the hotel don't know. You can't, you know, please say, I don't know, that way. So, few days later, after actually everything's not good, things will work here, so you will have to, you know. So, I was a family. And that's what I moved to Cambodia, I moved in November 2007. And I started working at home before. So I was working during the day, and during the night, and then I was working for during the day. So that was a job, I was in the college, I got my GED, and then in 2013 I got a degree. I started working for a nonprofit organization in Hazard. I was telling people about that was appreciated in the class, but then I realized that the heat is kind of good. I live in West Shore, but I work in Hazard. I go to Friday at 5, I live at 5 o'clock, and it's still not like that. I just spent my 3 to 5 o'clock job. And I was like, Alishine, out of 350,000 people who are there, and the company's company, I'm going to be, you know, start with 3 to 5, and we have this community. That included a thing. Something that I can't believe, but I was like, I have to do something else. So one day I just decided from the job that I have to do something else. So I decided to come in and work with an immigrant, not for the organization. And the reason I started with was the fact that there are 350,000 people in the camp each year, and they don't come in for a couple of chances to settle. You know, they're going to be the president of the organization. So, you have to do something, not only in this country, not only in the country, but also even in this country, even in our city, even in our county, like, they keep this planet. I mean, I don't want to go towards one of the giants and see this woman in a veil, you know, hijab or whatever you call it, and you look at her and say, you want to talk about it, you can't talk about it, you know. I will see, lady shopping, you know, and she's a physician, a person, she's white, I'm black, I'm refugee, she's, you know, a citizen, she's probably rich or poor, you know, it's something that kind of people, you know, that sets people apart. And because of this differences, you will not be able to connect. I'll tell a story. One day I was, this is some of the things that inspired me. One day I was in the hospital, and I had my son sitting, sitting on the corner, and there was this baby sitting in the corner, inside the hospital in Kerala. My son started playing with his hospital. So, you know, he's sitting on the corner, she's sitting in the corner, the children are playing there. Then we chatted, and so it's about an hour we went inside, we came back, she was going to try to play again, and I think, so I was in touch, I did my name, okay, and then we started tracking, and then you can't believe this. This woman is from the river, Mexico, for 3 years. Yeah. So my son, became friends that day. When we were leaving the hospital, we were still responding to the water, so we tried to lay, we were in the hospital, and then too, I think we found out that our son lost the leg, so I was unfortunate to be there, not to sleep or anything. So I called him today, I contacted some churches and see if we have some things to donate and not sleep. And then our culture was that thing, and then we exchanged the phone, and then we became friends. So that's what inspired me to pack up there and actually our goal is to connect communities, something called children, to see if we are all kind of understand each other in their own language, we can connect, we can bring us together, why not? do is to bring people together so that I mean, in fact, share this with my friend now. Then, in last year, 2018, we had a New Year Neighbor Dinner. We had a 300 people. And the thanks for the old school, for the organizing, and other ones, together, 21st, this year again. We want to bring people together so that we can appreciate our differences, we can help each other. I came to this country from 4 years ago, and from 4 years ago. I'm still, I work hard, but I'm still poor. Every day I see people who go through a lot of challenges. I remember a couple of years ago, there was a woman who came to this country as a refugee, and then she had 3 children. She cannot work. She cannot, because if she goes to work, no one is going to take care of her children. She does not have enough money to pay for daycare. And so I sent you a support checking. I said, today you can just help this person. She can cry, she can do anything. And so one volunteer said, we can help her. So one of the churches sent someone so that they can so we can help. And you know, we have to help. And then one day she came to our office and said she wants to be her husband because volunteers are in a temporary situation, but her husband comes that we be able to resolve her issues. So I completed that. She would go to a lawyer and he said, she went to a lawyer and he said, it's $3,000 to complete the application. And I said, I can complete the application for you, but you know, I already need to go money to pay the rent for, you know, already need to go money for my account to pay for the rent. I cannot pay for this temporary application. So, see, I sent some of the emails to local churches and said, anyway, you can pay for the postage, and all that. So something like $100, and then a check, and they are able to pay for that. So we have gone through the application, and today the person is here. He's driving. He has a car. He has 2 cars. We leave, and they don't even come with. Hard working and doing what we do, but we get any benefit from the government. And before, the woman depended on government, the children, everybody was dependent on government because she can't do anything. So, another story is a lady who's a neighbor. Her family consists of 11. Her children and her mother, and one adopted child, and her husband and family, all of them were Mexican, Somali, group. So she wanted to apply for a green card. The cost of the green card, the lawyer said, $3,400, that the whole family is like this in America. But then, the same way, I can only keep my time, but I can't keep. I mean, this also, I also have my own location, this one I can do. And so, the same thing I did with the local children, that this one talent, this woman wants to apply for it, there are 11 of them, there's no way she can pay, what can we do? And they said, well, they need to go see what they can do, and a couple of days later, they can make a check to plan that they've done. So I can process the application for her. Then I completed the application. Now they have basically 11 green cards. And next week they have a citizenship. And this was so easy to them. And again, the immigration fee, the amount you have to pay, let alone the regular fee for the road the reason why I shared my story is I don't expect to get a better home today. That was my aim. My aim is to connect people. That's most important. Some of my friends that I work with have two things to offer them that I do. When you live with you and you're so kind, you ask, what is that you do? What can we do to help you? I think it's a lot. Well, can I ask people for some help? That's not my way. My way is to find ways to bring them all come together, help our community, help our city, help our state. So we all want, I'm willing to help them.